Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will see the different types of dynamic RAM. Now if you see this random access memory or a RAM, it is an essential part of any computing device. So whether you see a laptop or mobile or any gaming console, you will find this RAM inside all these devices. Now we have already seen some of the videos regarding this random access memories, and in fact in the last video, we have compared this static RAM and the dynamic RAM in many aspects. So now in this video, let us see the different types of dynamic RAM and let us compare the different generation of dynamic RAMs in different aspects. So we will compare the different types of dynamic RAM in terms of their speed or bandwidth, in terms of their packaging standards in which they are available, and we will also see the different types of dynamic RAM in terms of the applications in which they are used. So now if you see the different generation of dynamic RAM, in each generation you will find that the improvement in the speed as well as the reduction in the power consumption. So if you see the very old generation of dynamic RAM, they were the asynchronous dynamic RAM. So it means that the RAM is not synchronized with the CPU clock. Now the disadvantage of this type of RAM was that CPU do not know the exact timing at which the data will be available from the RAM on this input output bus. And that problem has been overcome by the next generation of RAM, which is known as the synchronous DRAM. So in case of this SDRAM, the RAM is synchronized with the CPU clock. Now the advantage of this SDRAM is that the CPU, or to be precise, memory controller, exactly knows the timing or the number of cycles after which the data will be available on the bus. So CPU do not need to wait for the memory access. And because of that, we can increase the memory read and write speed. So now before we understand about this RAM, let us see the different terminologies which are quite oftenly used with these dynamic RAMs. So if you see this RAM, we have a total two types of different frequencies. The first is the input output clock frequency, and the second is the RAM internal clock frequency. So this input output clock frequency is the frequency at which the data is being transferred between the RAM and the memory controller. And the internal clock frequency of the RAM is the frequency which is being used by the RAM for the internal operations. So now here in case of this synchronous DRAM, this input output clock frequency and the internal clock frequency of the RAM are same. So suppose if the internal clock frequency of the RAM is 100 MHz, then the input output clock frequency is also 100 MHz. And generally if you see this synchronous DRAM, the operating frequency is in the range of 100 to 133 MHz. So suppose if you find the PC100 on the SDRAM module, it means that the input output bus clock frequency is 100 MHz, and data that is being transferred between this RAM and the memory controller is at the rate of 100 mega transfer per second. And if this bus is 64 bit wide, then the data rate in terms of the bits per second will be equal to 100 MHz into 64 bits. And if we convert it into the byte, then it will be divided by the 8 bits, that is 800 megabytes per second. So now the synchronous DRAM modules are operated at 3.3 volt. Now this SDRAM or a synchronous DRAM is also known as the Single Data Rate SDRAM, because in this RAM, the data is transferred at the every rising edge of the clock cycle. But if you see the next generation of synchronous DRAM, they are known as the DDR RAM, because in case of this DDR RAM, the data is transferred twice during the clock cycle, that is during the positive edge as well as the during negative edge. So in this way, the data is being transferred twice during the each cycle, and that is why it is known as a double data rate or DDR SDRAM. So if you see this DDR RAM, there are different generations in this DDR RAM, starting from the DDR1 up to the DDR4. And nowadays, the memories that we use inside the desktop, laptop or mobile, that is either DDR3 or DDR4 RAM. So let us see the different generation of this DDR RAM one by one. So the first generation of DDR RAM is known as the DDR1 RAM. So compared to the SDRAM, here the voltage has been reduced from 3.3 volt to the 2.5 volt. So like I said earlier, in case of this DDR RAM, the data is being transferred both during the rising as well as the falling edge. So we can say that in single clock cycle, instead of one bit, the two bits are being prefetched. So that is generally known as the 2-bit prefetch. Now here in this DDR1 RAM, the internal clock frequency as well as the input output bus clock frequency are same. So generally these DDR1 RAM are operated in the range of 133 MHz up to the 200 MHz. But if you see the data rate at the input output bus, it will be doubled compared to the clock frequency. As in case of this DDR RAM, the data is transferred both during rising as well as the falling edge. So suppose if you are operating this DDR1 RAM at 133 MHz, then you will see the data rate as 266 mega transfer per second. So suppose if the bus frequency is 200 MHz, then the data transfer rate will be equal to 400 mega transfer per second. And if the input output bus is 64 bits wide, then the data rate in terms of the bytes per second will be equal to 3200 megabytes per second. Now these DDR RAMs are generally denoted by the term DDR followed by the transfer rate of this RAM. And if you see the DDR1 module or a DDR1 stick, then on that stick you will find that the term which is used as PC3200. It means that the maximum speed or the maximum bandwidth which can be achieved by this DDR1 RAM is 3200 megabytes per second. So after the first generation of DDR1 RAM, the second generation of DDR RAM is the DDR2 RAM. So now in case of this DDR2 RAM, it is operated at 1.8 volt instead of 2.5 volt. And if you see the internal RAM clock frequency, the internal RAM clock frequency is same as the previous generation. But here the data rate is doubled compared to the last generation. And that is being achieved by increasing the number of bits that is being prefetched during each cycle. So in case of this DDR2 RAM, instead of 2 bits here, 4 bits are prefetched during each cycle. Or in simple way, if I say, in case of this DDR2 RAM, the internal bus width of this RAM has been doubled. So suppose if the input output bus is 64 bits wide, then the internal bus width of this RAM will be equal to 128 bits. So in this way, in a single cycle, we can handle a double amount of data. And to handle the same amount of data, the clock frequency of this input output bus should be get doubled. So suppose if this DDR2 RAM is operated at 100 MHz internal clock frequency, then the input output bus should have a clock frequency of 200 MHz. And in case of this DDR RAMs, as data is transferred both during rising and falling edge, so the data rate will be doubled compared to the clock frequency, that is 400 mega transfer per second. And in terms of the DDR terminology, it can be written as DDR2 followed by the transfer rate. So now suppose if DDR2 RAM is operated at 400 MHz clock frequency, then the data rate will be equal to 800 mega transfer per second. And in terms of the terminology, it can be written as DDR2 800. And if you see the DDR2 module, on the module, it will be written as PC2 6400, which means data rate in terms of the bytes per second. So after the second generation, the third generation of DDR RAM is the DDR3. So in case of this DDR3 RAM, the voltage is further reduced from 1.8 volt to the 1.5 volt. Now if you see the internal clock frequency of the RAM, it is slightly improved compared to the last generation, but the data rate that you can achieve with the same frequency is being doubled compared to the previous generation. Because in case of this DDR3 RAM, here the number of bits that is being prefetched is increased from 4 bit to the 8 bit. Or in simple way, if I can say, the internal data bus width of this RAM has been increased 2 times compared to the last generation. So in case of this DDR3 RAM, suppose if the internal clock frequency is 100 MHz, then to match the data rate, the input output bus should be get operated at 4 times the clock frequency, that is 400 MHz, and the transfer rate that you get will be equal to 800 mega transfer per second. So now on any DDR3 module, if you find the term that is DDR3 800 followed by PC3 6400, it means that this RAM is the DDR3 RAM which is operated at 1.5 volt and the clock frequency of this RAM is 400 MHz and the maximum transfer rate which can be achieved is 800 mega transfer per second and the maximum bandwidth of this RAM is 6400 megabytes per second. So after this third generation of DDR3 RAM, the next generation is the DDR4 RAM. Now here, in case of this DDR4 RAM, again the operating voltage has been reduced from 1.5 volt to the 1.2 volt. And here again, in case of this DDR4 RAM, the number of bits that is being prefetched is same as the previous generation, that is 8 bits per cycle. But now in case of this DDR4 RAM, the internal clock frequency of the RAM has been increased. So if you are operating at 400 MHz, then the clock frequency of this input output bus should be 4 times, that is 1600 MHz, and the transfer rate will be equal to 3200 mega transfer per second. So if you see the module, on the module you will find the term, that is PC4 followed by 25600, that is the speed in terms of megabytes per second. And in terms of the DDR terminology, you will find it as a DDR4 followed by the 3200. So now, so far whatever discussion that we carried out, we have assumed that the input output bus width is 64 bits. But if we increase this bus width, let's say if we double this bus width, then the theoretical data rate that can be achieved will be get doubled. So whenever this RAM is used in such mode, then it is known as the dual channel mode. So now suppose if you have two options, let's say one 8 GB of DDR4 RAM which is used as a single channel mode, and the two 4 GB of DDR4 RAMs which are used as a dual channel mode, then the bandwidth which can be achieved with this two 4 GB of DDR4 RAM will be better compared to the single channel 8 GB of DDR4 RAM. So now, so far we have seen the different generation of this dynamic RAMs in terms of their speed and the operating voltages. Now let us also see the different packages in which these dynamic RAMs are available. So very older generation of dynamic RAM were available in the dual inline package. Then after, the next generation of RAMs were available in the single inline module. So in case of the single inline module, these memory chips are soldered onto the one PCB and the pins are available on the single side of the PCB. So that is the reason this package is known as the single inline module, as the pins are available on the only one side of the PCB. Now here, this single inline module can provide a data bus width of 32 bits. So suppose if you want a 64 bits of data bus, then you need to connect the two single inline modules in a parallel. But then after, the next generation of RAMs were available in the dual inline module, or simply it is known as the DIMM. So in this dual inline module, it is possible to have a 64 bit wide data bus. And in this case, the pins were available both in front as well as the back of the PCB. And that is the reason it is known as the dual inline module. Now if you see the different generation of DDR RAMs, they were available in the DIMM modules. But all the modules have a different number of pins as well as the different operating voltage. So in a way, all the four generation of RAMs are not either forward or backward compatible. So suppose if you are having a motherboard which is supporting a DDR3 RAM, then it will not support either DDR2 or DDR4 RAM. So the DIMM modules which are available in these form factors are used inside the desktop or a personal computer. But if you see inside the laptop, the form factor of this DIMM module is quite compact, and it is known as the SO-DIMM, or simply small outline DIMM modules. So if you see the different generation of SO-DIMMs, it is having a different number of pins as well as a different operating voltage. Now so far, whatever discussion that we carried out, we had assumed that this RAM is used inside the either personal computer or a laptop. But this RAM is also categorized based on the applications in which it is being used. So the dynamic RAMs which are used inside the mobile or smartphone are known as the mobile DDR or a low power DDR. So these low power DDR RAMs are also having a different generation, starting from the LPDDR1 up to the LPDDR4. So if you see the 2017 flagships, they are operated on this LPDDR4X RAM. So these LPDDR RAMs are optimized for the lower power consumption, because these RAMs are used inside the smartphone which is having a small amount of battery. So this type of RAMs has to be optimized based on the power consumption. So the operating voltage of this LPDDR RAM is less compared to the DDR RAMs which are used inside the desktop and the laptops. Similarly, the RAMs which are used for the graphic cards is known as the graphic DDR or simply GDDR. Now, as these graphical DDRs are used for the multimedia applications, so the amount of data that needs to be handled is quite more. So that is the reason this type of GDDR RAMs is having a more bandwidth compared to the desktop and the laptop memories. So that is all about the different types of RAM which are used in the different applications. So I hope in this video you got an overview of the different types of dynamic RAM. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.